I was not the founder of Project Censored. That happened 38 years ago by a professor named Dr. Carl Jensen. And 18 years ago, he retired and I took over as director. And then 5 years ago, I stopped being director, and Mickey Huff is now the author, lead author of the current books, and another associate director, Andy Roth. So they're doing the books now. They just finished the 2015 book this year. That's our 20th book. But for 38 years, we've been putting out lists of news stories, the most important that the corporate media didn't cover. We now have 20 campuses involved, 50 professors, well over 200 students, and a website that generates 400,000 unique views a month. So we're constantly posting news stories, and then at the end of each year, and all these news stories have been reviewed by faculty members on these campuses. So we're vetting news stories. We call them validated independent news. We post them on our website. And then in April of every year, we all collectively vote on them, and that's how the top 25 get picked, and they end up in the book. So it's a long, thorough process of reviewing and that. And in 38 years, we've never had a story disproven, and we're quite proud of that. We put a whole lot of stuff up on our website, and we have some 50 writers, and so we can't be responsible for everything they write. But we're certainly responsible for everything that's in our book, and watch very closely what's happening on our website. So thank you very much, the Fellowship of Reconciliation. I'm honored to be here. And put together a talk that's kind of been evolving, for me particularly. And I'll just start out by saying, in 1795, at a meeting at the Pelican Inn, in Speenhamlin, England, a number of local magistrates devised a system to alleviate stress caused by high grain prices, because the Napoleonic Wars had increased the price of food. Authorities at Speenhamlin approved a means-tested scaling scale of wage supplements in order to mitigate the worst effects of poverty. Essentially, families were paid extra to bring their income up to a level to prevent starvation. Payments varied according to number of children and the price of bread. Speenham laws were established to prevent declining productivity in the workforce. You can't have all your workers dying. And so instead of setting wages at a level adequate for living, low wages were supplemented by the state to a level high enough to prevent starvation. And of course, at the same time, protecting employers' profits. Recently, a Canton, Ohio Walmart decided to hold a food drive for local needy families on a holiday. What made this a tragic nightmare was the needy families were mostly Walmart employees. Walmart workers received $2.6 billion a year in government help, $1 billion in health care alone. This works out to about $5,800 per worker, or about $420,000 per store. In Wisconsin, it's close to $1 million per store because their benefits are higher. Speenhamlin is alive and well in the United States today. Walmart has 2.2 million employees, employees all over the U.S. They generate $475 billion in sales, with profits about $17 billion a year. They're the largest discount retail space in the market, in the country, with taking 66% of the market share. 100 million shoppers patronize Walmart every week. They have twice the number of employees as Postal Service and the world's largest fleet of trucks. Americans spend $36 million per hour at Walmart stores. Each week, it has 200 million customers in their 10,000 plus stores in 27 countries worldwide. So little has changed since 1795, except that the magnitude of the scale. Among the richest people in the world, if we looked at Forbes' list, number 8, 12, 13, and 14 are all Waltons. Jim, Robson, Alice, and Christie. They're each worth about $34 to $37 billion for a family total of about $140 billion. Therefore, we have some of the richest people in the world being subsidized by governments in order to protect their profits and keep wages low. There's something wrong with this idea. So this is the type of story that Project Censored has highlighted for the past 38 years. Some of our new stories we're working on, ocean acidification. We're talking about 20 trillion pounds a year of carbon dioxide going into the waters. And this is changing the CO2 mix. It lowers the pH levels. It's impacting shellfish, coral reefs around the world. The oceans are dying. That looks like it's going to be our number one story this year. Another one we're working on is the top 10 nations that receive U.S. foreign assistance all practice torture and are responsible for human rights abuse. That's Israel, Afghanistan, Egypt, Pakistan, Nigeria, Jordan, Iraq, Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda. And then there's, censorship stories. The World Health Organization continues to suppress massive evidence that the U.S. use of depleting uranium in Iraq caused birth defects and major public health issues. So we ask the questions. Why does corporate media fail to cover and investigate important news stories that reflect inequalities of race, class, gender, or fail to address issues of corruption and a massive human misery perpetrated by the capitalist states and the U.S. NATO empire? Why are the airways filled with junk food news and mindless trivia while 30,000 people around the world die daily from malnutrition and easily cured diseases? Why does the U.S. NATO empire deploy occupying forces, private mercenaries, and special force kill teams in over 130 countries in the world? Why is the president killing humans, including American citizens, without trial or due process, with predator drones flown from remote locations anywhere in the world? Why does the media fail to report on the election fraud in the U.S.? George W. Bush was never elected to the presidency. Some of you have read the books. Both the election of 2000 and 2004 were manipulated via voting machines and registration purges. And many research has been done on this, but the corporate media won't touch it. So to really answer these questions, we have to look at the media and the controlling interests within the Western capitalist powers. Ed Herman and Noam Chomsky, in their book Manufacturing Consent, published 24 years ago, claim that because media is firmly embedded in the market system, it reflects the class values and concerns of its owners and advertisers. Well, kind of makes sense. And according to Herman and Chomsky, the media maintains a corporate bias through these five systematic filters: concentrated private ownership, a strict bottom-line profit orientation, over-reliance on government and corporate sources for the news, a strong tendency to avoid offending the powerful, and an almost religious worship of the marketplace economy, in opposition to any opposing things like socialism or other things. So these filters become more evident as news and society. They set parameters in terms of what's covered daily and how it's covered. Fox will actually put out memorandums to all their anchors saying, this is how you will cover this news story. It goes out daily. However, media consolidation and the expansion of public relations firms inside news systems in the world today, when they were writing that, that was about the point where there were 25 major corporations in the world. When we started, there were 50, and now there's less than 10 media, big news corporations. So the corporate media is deeply interlocked with the global policy elite, the military-industrial complex, to use Eisenhower's terms. Media is increasingly dependent on various government and corporate sources for news. So there's a constant 24-hour news connection between MSNBC, Fox, CNN, and the Pentagon, the White House, the State Department. They keep offices there. And so they're constantly being fed news stories, both from private corporations, public relation firms, so that almost literally all the news we're seeing on television is prepackaged or pre-spun by a PR firm. Simply put, censorship is more than blatant. It's not just outright omission. We face what appears to be a military-industrial media empire so powerful and complex that truth is mostly absent or reported in disconnected segments with little historical context. For several years, Project Censored has been describing the impacts of censorship as a truth emergency in the U.S. and the world. Among the most important centuries of the past decade and a half has to be the number of civilians that died in Iraq. This, of course, is not, there was over a million since we invaded in 2003. This does not cover the other million that died in the first Gulf War during the sanctions. So in the Iraq War, beginning in March 2003, over a million people died violently, primarily from U.S. bombing and neighborhood patrols. These deaths were in excess of the normal civilian population, so we have those records, and then surveys have been done. Among military leaders of the policy elite, the issue of counting the dead was dismissed even before we invaded Iraq. General Tommy Franks said in 2002, we don't do body counts. But we have this evidence now. In 2008, the British polling group, Opinion Research, they had surveyed 15 of the 18 provinces in Iraq, asking people, did anyone in your family die from war violence? And this was like a Gallup poll, but face-to-face. It was quite an extensive, well-documented poll, and that's where they came up with 1,033,000 people. And that was in 2008. And this was on the heels of two other studies, both done and published in the Lancet by John Hopkins University, published in Lancet magazine, medical journal. One in 2003, just a year into the war, of 100,000 deaths at that time, and then one in 2006 showing 650,000 deaths. And that's the one where they asked the people how their loved ones died, and half were U.S. aerial bombing or U.S. troops killing them in neighborhoods. So we killed a whole massive numbers of people. So the magnitude of 1 million-plus deaths is undeniable, and then these are just the people who have died. 1 million more have been wounded physically and mentally. 5 million were displaced from their homes. The occupation by the U.S. forces guaranteed a monthly mass death in thousands of people. A carnage so severe and so concentrated that to equate it with the most serious mass killings in world history. More tons of bombs were dropped on Iraq than all of World War II. And before that, Vietnam, more bombs were dropped than all of World War II, just particularly in Laos. The carnage continues with an ongoing sectarian violence inside Iraq, fanned, both sides being fanned, we know, by U.S. interests. So where does all this come from? What are we dealing with here? My political sociology background was looking at power elites and C. Wright Mills, and Bill Domhoff was on my dissertation committee. And we know that the American ruling class has been self-perpetuating, and it maintains itself through policy institutions such as the National Manufacturers Association, the Chamber of Commerce, Business Council, Business Roundtable, Conference Board, American Enterprise Institute, Council on Foreign Relations, the Heritage Foundation, Hoover Institute, and various other policy groups, which the politicians look to for guidance and understanding what the policies need to be. C. Wright Mills, in his book, The Power Elite, stated that power elite comprise corporate, military, and government elites in a centralized power structure motivated by class interests and working in unison through higher circles of contact and agreement. That was back in 56, so it was present then, particularly after World War II. It was present before, but it really got consolidated during World War II and continues to the day, only now it's become transnational. Estimates are the total world's wealth is about $200 trillion. And the U.S. and Europe hold approximately 63% of that. Now, to be in the top 1%, that 1% idea that Occupy gave us all, which was certainly a gift of understanding, but to be in the 1%, your assets really only need to be about $600,000. But the difference inside the 1%, I mean, I know a lot of people whose houses are worth that, right? But that puts you in the top 1%, it really does, in terms of assets in the world and people. You've got half the world living on a couple dollars a day, so think of that that way. Now, this top 1%, particularly the top 10% of the 1%, they've hidden away something like $30 trillion in secret tax-exempt bank accounts all over the world. So, and these capitalist power elites, they exist everywhere in the world. The globalization of trade and capital brings the world elites into increasingly interconnected relationships, to the point that sociologists today are beginning to theorize about a transnational capitalist class. Foremost among the early works of the idea of an interconnected transnational corporate class was Leslie Sklar's book in 2001 called The Transnational Capitalist Class. When I read that 13, 14 years ago now, I go, wow, this is interesting. Because, you know, we looked at nation elites at that point. State theory, power elite theory was really about nation states. And they were starting to speculate and say, well, where are we going with this? Now, this transnational class is within transnational corporations. They have international roles. Their states of origin become less important than the international agreements developed through the World Trade Organization and other international institutions. From these multinational corporations is forming a transnational capitalist class whose loyalties and interests, while still rooted in their corporations, are increasingly international in scope. Now, deeper inside the transnational corporate class is what David Rothkopf calls a superclass. Rothkopf, he was the former managing director of Kissinger Associates, and he was deputy undersecretary of commerce for a while. He published a book in 2008 called The Superclass, The Global Power Elite in the World They Are Making. According to Rothkopf, the superclass is about 0.001%, 6 to 7,000 people worldwide. These are the Davos-attending, Gulfstream, jet-flying, mega-corporation-interlocked, policy-planning elites of the world. They're at the absolute peak of the global power structure. They are 94% male, predominantly white, mostly from North America and Europe. Rothkopf reports that these are the people they set the agendas at the G8, the G20, NATO, the World Bank, and the World Trade Organizations. These are the policy formation people of the world. Now, Project Censored, in our 2014 book, we study the people on the board of directors of the top 10 largest asset management firms in the world and the top 10 most centralized corporations in the world. The Swiss did a really good study of several hundred thousand corporations and networked them all together, and we took their top 10 and the top 10 largest management companies, money management companies, and lo and behold, there was there was an overlap. We really only have those two top 10 groups. There was only 13 separate companies. Now, that includes Barclays Bank, BlackRock, Inc. in New York, Capital Group Companies, FMR, Fidelity Worldwide, AXA, State Street Corporation out of Chicago, JP Morgan Chase, Legal Group, Vanguard, UBS, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, Credit Suisse, Allianz SE, and PEMCO Pacific Investment Management. The boards of directors of these firms are 161 individuals. They fit here. They are the financial core of the world's transnational capitalist class. They all know each other or know of each other. and they collectively manage $24 trillion worth of wealth. 161 people. So the institutional arrangements within money management systems of global capital, their job is to increase and maximize return on investment. Now think about that. You've got trillions of dollars you need to invest. You need to have safe places to invest. You want to get a return, ideally 7% or better. And there are structural conditions that maybe allow you to manipulate things a little bit or fudge a little here and there. That was what the LIBOR scandal was about, fudging on the interest rates on money exchanges. There's a variety of ways to do that. But what happens is these institutions have become too big to fail. Their scope and interconnections pressure government regulators to shy away from criminal investigations, much less prosecutions. And even if somebody is prosecuted, then in a few years they're back in the bank systems anyway. The result is a semi-protected class of people with increasingly vast amount of money, seeking unlimited growth and returns, with little concern for consequences of their economic pursuits on other people, societies, cultures, and the environment. The job is to get more money back from the money you have. And the costs, the environmental costs, the opportunity costs are not there. It's immediate return. That's the goal. Now, these 161 core members, 84% are male, 88% are European or descent, or U.S. European descent, 52 hold graduate degrees, 30-some MBAs, 14 JDs, 21 PhDs, so they're a highly educated group of people. They go to private colleges. Of the half attended either Harvard, Oxford, Stanford, Cambridge, Chicago, Cologne, Columbia, Cornell, Pennsylvania, or Berkeley. So they may even have known each other in college. Some 50 of them worked, either had prior experience at Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs, Lehman Brothers, Barclays, Swiss Re Insurance, Salomon Brothers, and Merrill Lynch. They're from 22 nations, 45% from the U.S., 16% from Britain, 14% from France, 12% from Germany, and then it's spread around between Switzerland, Austria, Belgium, India, Australia, South Africa, Brazil, Vietnam, Hong Kong, Qatar, Netherlands, Zambia, Taiwan, Kuwait, Mexico, and Colombia. Those are the core. So it's global. And they live mostly in either New York, Chicago, London, Paris, or Munich. Now, these members of this financial core, we studied all their biographies. They're posted online, so you can see who these people are. Five of the 13 corporations had directors or advisors in the International Monetary Fund. Six had advisors to the World Bank. 13 had members in the Council on Foreign Relations. Seven of the firms sent 19 directors to the World Economic Forum in 2013. Seven were currently on the Federal Reserve boards. Six were part of the Business Roundtable in the U.S. Several were working with financial ministries in Europe. And final ministry and the G20. Almost all of them, there was only like one guy in Germany that wasn't on anything that we could find, but are in some regulatory fashion advisors, finance ministers, on boards of directors of universities or major policy-making organizations. So Western governments and international policy bodies serve the interests, not specifically of this core, but certainly the interests of capitalism, and this core is their primary advisors. Wars are initiated to protect their interests. International treaties and policy agreements are arranged to promote their success. Power elites serve to promote the free flow of global capital for investment anywhere the returns are possible. That's Africa, Asia, wherever. The U.S. NATO military empire operates in service to the transnational corporate capital's global domination agenda. That's what NATO and U.S. empire is about. It's an unrelenting quest for capital growth. The empire seeks nothing less than full neoliberal economic control of the world resources and the full subjugation of human labor. To say that anything less than, I mean, that would, that's what they want. To say anything less ignores 500 years of capitalism that's resulted in world wars, enslavement, millions of deaths, continuing states of permanent war against any resistance by states or peoples. The current crisis in the Ukraine is but one step in the unrelenting consolidation control of transnational capital. Start to frame what's really happening in the world in that context. The global circulation of capital is at the core of international bourgeoisie, who operate in globalistic clusters around the world. Clusters of elites form strategic transnational alliances through mergers and acquisitions with the goal of increased concentration of wealth and capital. This creates a hegemonic elite in the world. Concentration of wealth and power at a level tends to overaccumulate, leading to speculative investments. Where can we invest? And so grain prices will go up, housing prices will go up. All these crises that we've seen are really about speculative investment. Economic growth, regional wars. Transnational corporate class makes effort to correct and protect its interests through global organizations like the World Bank, the IMF, the G20, the World Economic Forum and Trilateral Commission, Bilderberger Group, Bank of International Settlements, and other transnational organizations. These transnational institutions are in service to this class, and they rely on the U.S. NATO hegemony in the world to enforce global arrangements in support of governments favorable to their agenda. Governments unsupportive to transnational capitalist interests are pressured to comply or undermine in a quest for regime change. Inside the governments of the U.S. NATO allies are various intelligence agencies who operate from within a deep state that remains outside the public realm. This is Peter Dale Scott talking, his work on the deep state. Within this system, nation states become little more than population containment zones, and the real power lies within the decision makers who control global capital and encourage the implementation and overt and covert actions to maintain and expand their domination. So the world's corporate media, which is in turn owned and controlled by this class, pays absolutely no attention to the academic concepts like transnational capitalist class. We did a LexisNexis search on that, and we found two mentions, both in foreign media, and one by a letter to the editor by Leslie Sklar. That's it. Nobody talks about this. And there's even reluctance inside the academy to address these kinds of issues. The corporate media of the U.S. covers foreign unrest in various countries as if they are silos. Countries in war crisis are treated as isolated cases when nation-state decision-makers and various opposition groups create tensions that result in civil unrest or regime changes. During these periods of international chaos, human rights violations occur. The corporate media identifies the perpetrators as evil Hitler-like regime leaders. And if human rights are violated, humanitarian military intervention is demanded by all the peace-loving people in the world. At least that's what the media tells us. The U.S. NATO deep state intelligence apparatuses engage in systematic undermining of regimes targeted for change for governments more acceptable to international capital. Practices of how U.S. NATO empire conducts deep state efforts for regime change in various countries are becoming now more sociologically observable. If we review the histories of the U.S. NATO deep state activities that have happened in the past two decades in Afghanistan, Iraq, Iran, Venezuela, Yugoslavia, El Salvador, Libya, Syria, Ukraine, we begin to see particular practices or similar practices that demonstrate this unrelenting surge of power inside the U.S. NATO regimes. While some of these cases, the regimes have not yet been changed, each case has been ideologically justified recently by war on terror or humanitarian interventions. So if we look at the patterns in these different countries, and you can see this in Ukraine, you can see this in Syria, Libya, Egypt to a certain extent, there's a long-term funding. The first step really is long-term funding of opposition parties. That's certainly been ongoing in Venezuela for quite a while. Special projects and things called democracy building that's funded by the U.S. International Development, USAID, or the National Endowment for Democracy, or has been present in almost all these nations. They work in cooperation with domestic and foreign intelligence agencies, private corporations, non-governmental organizations, U.S. ambassador, and it's usually, or the CIA head of group is usually the ones coordinating these activities inside these countries. These efforts include the organization of opposition leaders ready for assumption of governmental authority at the correct time. All the above associated with a continued public relations effort by PR firms in service to the empire to provide cooperative media that and inside managed news that demonizes the regime that we want removed. Step two, funds are provided to opposition groups to organize public events, mass rallies, demonstrations against the regime, and with a desire of creating incidents that reflect human rights violations, then those are loudly denounced in the global media. If you think about, you know, Syria, you think about Ukraine, think about Libya, each of these steps is evident. It was certainly evident even before that. Venezuela. Covert consultation, funding of violent opposition acts can occur at this junction. Step three is where it gets pretty dangerous. Efforts are made to create violent incidences whereby innocent victims are injured and killed. Support of false flag operations such as the use of sarin gas in Syria, sniper shootings in Libya, Ukraine, and Venezuela are blamed on the targeted regime. When I was in Caracas, they took me to show me this hotel. They said, well, we were marching across this bridge and gunshots were fired, people were killed. It was blamed on Hugo Chavez, but there was no involvement there. They were mercenaries that had been hired by external forces to come in. Step four, the transnational class U.S.-NATO empire then start issuing global demands calling for humanitarian interventions combined with economic and trade sanctions, cutting off the regime's access to international banking and credit or individuals within the regime, which is what we've been doing to some Russians now in terms of Ukraine. This phase involves UN resolutions, proposed military activities by NATO and the U.S., IMF, World Bank sanctions, and indictments of specific individuals by the International Criminal Court. So they really ramp it up. Finally, either the regime collapses or violent military coup takes place, removing non-cooperating officials and opposition forces take command of the government. U.S. NATO forces initiate military actions if this isn't successful and do things such as no-fly zones, bombings, invasions, assassinations, and occupations. In the case of Libya and Ukraine, the gold deposits of the regime were transferred to U.S. NATO control. While these patterns of intervention are mostly readily observable from the histories of the past two decades, various elements of these patterns go back hundreds of years. Practices occurred, such practices required a continuing ideological justification. In U.S. history, manifest destiny, democracy building, fighting the communist conspiracy, war on terror have each in turn been the cultural narrative, the ideological justification for capital expansion and economic control of various regions and people. Certainly for the U.S., the idea of manifest destiny and American exceptionalism allowed the subjugation of entire continent of native people and the Mexican territories. Bringing democracy to the people was the ideological justification for the U.S. invasion and occupation of Hawaii, Cuba, Puerto Rico, the Philippines a century ago, and many nations since then. So the ideology of ideological fighting the global communist conspiracy after World War II justified the U.S. and capitalist allies' engagements in Korea, Southeast Asia, and various other nations, including Guatemala, Iraq, and Iran. So that intense ideological divide, ultimate power struggle after World War II between communism and capitalism, supposedly ended with the collapse of the USSR. However, the five-century agenda of global capital domination never ended and continues in the present under the guise of the war on terror and humanitarian interventions. However, the ideological justification for the U.S.-NATO empire intervention in Ukraine does not fit in terms of a war of terror or humanitarian intervention. The U.S.-NATO capitalist challenge to Russia is clearly more evident in the case of Ukraine. So it appears that in 2013, we are seeing the return of the ideological rhetoric of Cold War and a nuclear standoff, possible nuclear engagements. The transnational class, without noting the hypocrisy, disseminated criticism of Russia's imperial aggression by the U.S. officials themselves. They're saying, well, that's the, you know, Putin is has these imperial desires. In fact, George W. Bush, the speechwriter David Frum, tweeted, if Russia were acts the outlaw nation, it can't be expected to be treated as anything but an outlaw. Kerry claimed, you just don't invade another country on a phony pretext in order to assert your interests. Right. When asked about the similarity to the Russian invasion of the Crimea, and they didn't really invade, they didn't, I mean, they had troops there already. And in the U.S. invasion of Iraq, Obama said, well, at least America sought to work with the international system. So if we look at the news coverage of Ukraine and Syria, vis-a-vis Russia and the U.S. NATO empire, it kind of illuminates the reemergence of an existence of a Cold War anti-Russia frame. Corporate media sees nothing more than evil leaders in Iran and Syria who are committing human rights violations, and the president of Russia is encouraging these evildoers as a co-partner in the crimes. Regarding the Ukraine, the corporate media are setting a global frame of international tension, brinksmanship, similar to early on in the Cold War with Berlin, Vietnam, and Cuba. We keep setting these things. And the U.S. are accelerating a crisis with tension-filled statements, military threats, expanded military capabilities and bases, and a tightening ring of containment around Russia and, of course, China as well. A brinksmanship appearing in the Ukraine must be understood as inevitable in the context of a 500-year history of capital expansion. This is not new, but we have to frame it in this understanding. Unrelenting deep state manipulations by U.S. NATO intelligence agencies are in service and cooperation to transnational capital. Key multinational corporations stand to benefit from new resources and war spending will often be included in the planning and implementation of covert operations. In fact, Peter Dale is saying that probably two-thirds of the black op budget is really inside of corporations. So understanding kind of a theory of deep state power, things that are going on that we don't know about, and observing similar patterns of crisis creation is now more readily available. We can start to really see what the patterns are. The war on terror is simply not sustainable as a long-term justification for global power concentration. It's worked real well since the collapse of the Soviet Union, but it's not going to work real well when we start to really occupy or become more involved with those countries surrounding Russia. Ukraine underscores the idea that the larger frame of the U.S. versus USSR and NATO versus USSR is reemerging to justify interventions in that region. So our understanding of the need for a new Cold War media frame can help us a lot in terms of understanding the continuing efforts by the deep state NATO empire to build total neoliberal capital control over the entire world. Also see the patterns of deep state politics will become increasingly easier to observe capital concentrations globally. Transnational corporate class is becoming more transparent as the 99% recognizes the power and the need for continued growth and consolidation by the 1,000th of 1%. So we can see this. We can observe it. By watching and calling out the lies of the NATO empire, we can support our own democratic movements. We can encourage leaders elsewhere to recognize the patterns of power and take steps to resist. The American people and others around the world are faced with a serious moral dilemma. Murder and war crimes are being conducted in our name. Yet many Americans have no idea of the magnitude of the deaths and tend to believe that the U.S. intervenes for humanitarian and democratic purposes. Knowing that the U.S. NATO empire really interferes globally to protect capital expansion and the transnational capital class, it's vital understanding for the people in 99%. That consciousness needs to emerge. Consumers of corporate television in the U.S., especially those whose understandings are framed primarily from that medium alone, all my students, none of them read newspapers anymore. They're under 30, nobody reads a newspaper. And it's not so much that the newspapers tell us the whole, any more of the story than TV news. TV is just meant to be more entertainment. Well, part of the 99% are, they're embedded in a sea of junk food news and disinformation. The result is, to varying degrees, a population living in a state of an excited delirium. It's very exciting to watch all that television news. An excited delirium of knowinglessness. Now, to counter knowinglessness, we must build truth from the bottom up, critical thinking, which is what we're training hundreds of students every year to do in the various Project Censored groups all over the country. Fact-finding are the basis of democracy. We must stand for the maximization of informed, participatory democracy at the lowest possible level in society. We must continue to openly discuss, research, and validate our issues. As activists, we must see ourselves as an important part of building a new, non-exploitive world based on freedom of information, democracy, and human rights. We face a global empire of corporate military power that is unrelenting in propagandizing its subjects with fear and disinformation. It falls to us to take a stand on truth and transparency by encouraging independent media and research regarding the manipulations of the powerful. We have a public education role and a responsibility for both training critical thinkers in society and expanding public knowledge and awareness of inconvenient truths. Commonality of purpose can help guide us in these endeavors. The principles espoused in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights offer a fundamental foundation of values that social institutions, political organizations, churches, colleges, universities, high schools, grammar schools, and families can openly share. It's up to us to retain a belief in the Enlightenment and the early free thought movements in the U.S. Common sense. We are the organizations that can offer hope for people to unite and oppose the common oppressors manifested in militaristic and unresponsive governments. Only when the public forms and controls its own information resources will it become truly armed with the power that knowledge gives to create a new and truly vibrant democratic society, and promises as well, delivers liberty, peace, and prosperity to all. Corporate media lies to us, and they're getting better at it. And it's not just a privacy issue anymore, it is a cognitive liberty issue. Freedom of thought or cognitive liberty is a natural human right of each person to be secure in their ability to perceive the world to the best possible. To have the true cognitive liberty in a world as complex as ours means that we must have access to truthful and unbiased information about the actions of others and the general state of the world. The Center for Cognitive Liberty defines this as a right of each individual to think independently and autonomously, to use the full spectrum of his or her mind, and to engage in multiple modes of thought. In the 1960s, we called this power to the people. Thank you.
One of the underlying assumptions of a Project Censored is the idea of censorship or the lack of access to information. But things have changed over the last 10 or 15 years to where now we have YouTube. The quality of television on YouTube is higher quality than what's on broadcast television. And so there really isn't really a problem of censorship or even a production of video and audio content in broadcast quality. So what now that the problem is really that people don't want to watch it because it's not interesting. Or what is the problem? Why are people still watching any television or reading any newspapers now that we have the internet and we have no, you know, the road is wide open. So what's holding us back?
Well, the internet is so vast that many people just don't know who to trust. And one of our agendas is to identify independent news sources, and you can go to our website and you'll see a number listed that we think are trustworthy.
Give us a name.
Amy Goodman. Amy Goodman, of course. Truth Out, Common Dreams. I mean, Al Jazeera, kind of, they switched about 5 years ago and became more pro-Western. Even Press TV from Iran are okay. I mean, usually their news content is very good. I think RT is probably one of the best right now in terms of television news, Russia Today. But nobody's perfect. And, you know, I read all of Global Research's, everything they put out, that Michelle Cheskadowski puts out. And sometimes there's mistakes there, but mostly they're pretty good. But it's a variety of sources, but it's also having the ability to critical thinking and knowing how to research and verify what's being presented. And most people, you know, they're working full time and they've got kids or whatever. I mean, it's just literally impossible to keep up with that. So finding a couple of good sources that you look at pretty regularly and trying to get Amy Goodman and Pacifica News sources, and you can listen to our Project Censored show weekly online through KPFA in Berkeley, and there's some pretty good sources and places to go. But it does require unrelenting effort. But it needs to be done in groups and ways of understanding, be able to talk about it with people. That's why these kinds of organizations are so very important.
I was wondering, in Oregon we have a lot of local radio programs starting. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. People are getting together and starting their own programs. How can we coordinate that better so that we can have really good material put on and shared from the different stations? We needed to have a sharing quality to our radio stations.
There are some networks that are doing that to a certain extent, yeah. In fact, I was investigating because we've been marketing our Project Censored show to other stations, and it's Ashland picked it up. That's probably the closest. We haven't got anybody up here yet. But we've been doing it for 3 years, an hour-long program that Mickey and I do at KPFA, and then we put it up on the internet. You can look on our website and see. But we're in New York, we're in Washington, D.C., and a dozen other stations around the country. But
any other ideas?
I love KBOO. I mean, I think they're great. I keep wanting them to run our show. But, I mean, these are locally controlled, so people make decisions about what content they're going to have. And it's very important that we all do that and make sure that we're covering all aspects of what people need, including cultural, music, and news and information. And I worry in terms of Pacifica that it's becoming, the movement in Pacifica right now, and the new board of directors there is really, they want to make it more like an NPR station. And the news is unfortunately, it's kind of a whole lot of AP content. And I've been very critical of that, and a number of us have been, and there's ongoing fights on that on the national board and that. But it's going to take grassroots effort to try to have sources that are independent and not just, because it's too easy just to use AP and New York Times Wire and say, well, this happened in Syria, and you don't get a context for it. You need a deeper understanding. So it's vital, but having these micro stations get established, being interconnected, being able to play each other's work, then having local people involved, I think it's really important. Those voices have to be out there. And they have to be available to us so we can have voices and find out about people locally that we can go and meet with and talk with and have events with.
I sort of was hearing you say that the Assad regime has something to do with this corporate megalopathy or whatever.
The Assad, any regime, any Assad, certainly Saddam Hussein, certainly Gaddafi, were dictators inside of their own countries in many ways, or certainly very powerful. The elections were shams. But they weren't cooperating with the agendas of neoliberalism and the transnational corporate class, and that targeted them for being removed. In fact, Gaddafi was going as far as trying to get all the African nations to charge to be paid in gold for oil.
But so are you saying this corporate hegemony and power is influencing Assad to be conducting the violence that's being conducted in this country?
The transnational, the deep state intelligence agencies in service to capital organized the resistance and paid for the resistance and brought fighters into Syria to get rid of Assad. Saudis were involved, they were paying for it. The events, the steps that I laid out we've been experiencing that to the point where they used the sarin gas. Now is absolutely proven it wasn't Assad that used it. And
so
it did get all the sarin gas removed out of Syria under threat of U.S. bombing. So that was his gas counter, his stockpiles of gas were designed to counter Israel's nuclear capabilities. Now that's been removed. So there's an agenda in terms of supporting Israel issues there. Same way with Iraq. Israel, our agenda has been to divide that country up for a long time. The more chaos there is in the world, particularly in resource wealth areas, the more chaos there is, the stronger it makes the empire.
I mean, is the West responsible for everything?
There was all kinds of inequalities and problems there. And there was various groups of peoples and ethnicities inside of Syria, including Kurds, who I'm now in communication with a new radio station in eastern Syria that's Kurd-run. But those were all present. But turning that into a military chaos situation was certainly stimulated by intelligence agency interests in our realm. In fact, Robert Ford was the ambassador to Gaddafi, orchestrated that revolt, and brought in mercenaries to fight there. He had been in Iraq as the undersecretary. His next assignment was Syria, which he was actually staying in Egypt because after the whole thing started there. But these agents of the U.S. will orchestrate. And so some of the same fighters that were fighting Gaddafi are now in Syria. And the whole Benghazi thing was about transferring weapons through Benghazi, through Turkey, and Jordan to fighters in Syria to undermine the Assad regime.
Let's rewind this just a little bit and talk about the various news medias. You put MSNBC right in the middle of a whole bunch of other news organizations. And we've got Amy Goodman, of course, on one side or one, on your left, my left.
On the moderate left, yeah.
Yes, and, Where does MSNBC and especially Rachel Maddow fit into all of this, and how do you think about that?
Liberal ostriches come to mind. I mean, there's certain things Rachel Maddow just won't see. And but corporate media has framed, and even for the left or the left liberal groups, if they get outside the frame, they're gone. And so much of what corporate media does is really deliberate. Misinformation implies it's not deliberate, but disinformation says that it is. And we got a whole lot of that ongoing. So I have little faith in any corporate media newscast other than to maybe get the weather right once in a while. And I mean, I'll certainly tell you who died in your area and what car wrecks there were and what fires are going on, things like that. Yeah, who was shot and killed. But, and it's meant to shock you, it's meant to make you afraid, it's meant to reinstate and justify, you know, a police state in the country. Our study this year, and I didn't even mention this because we go micro-macro, but our study this year is police killings in the U.S. And we interviewed 14 families who lost a loved one in law enforcement-related deaths in the San Francisco Bay Area between 2000 and 2010. We researched newspapers in three different time periods to establish how many people are being killed by police, and it's around 600 to 700 a year, and which is about double what the FBI says is happening. And there's another 800 to 900 that die usually in the first week inside of city and county jails. So about 1,500 people a year dying through law enforcement. And the family members, all 14 families said that their loved one shouldn't have died, that it was mishandled and they were murdered. Four of them were shot in the back. And all of them were treated quite badly by the police. They're immediately isolated, they're taken down to the station, they're put in rooms, they're lied to, they're telling them their loved one's still alive, we'll let you know, tell us about it. They go into defense mode immediately if an officer kills somebody. That'll be out in our new book, and it's pretty devastating. And really, we did a research on all the police culture material that's out there, and we just, you know, nobody understands the magnitude of deaths that are happening, and we think that's a real important thing to address.